you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and the name of the Holy Ghost. Obedient to the great commissioner and to the great head of the church, upon your testimony, I baptize you in the name of the Father, name of the Son, and the name of the Holy Ghost.
I'm gonna pray.
Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the new candidates. We didn't baptize them to save them, for they already been quickened by the Spirit by your resurrection. But we just showed the outward showing to this congregation. And we thank you. We pray that your Spirit rest upon them. And Lord, we just thank you. In Jesus' name we pray, in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the precious Holy Ghost.
Amen. Thank you, sir. Come on, stand with me this morning. That's a simple little praise song. I love you, Jesus. I worship and adore you. I just want to tell you, Lord, I love you more than anything. Come on, help me.
And I love Jesus. I worship and adore.
Just wanna tell you.
Just want to tell you.
Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you
more than anything. How many of you love the Lord this morning? Lift your voice all over the room. I love you, Jesus. I worship and adore you. Just want to tell you, Lord, I love you more than anything. I love you. I can't hear nobody. I worship. Just wanna tell you.
Just want to tell you.
Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you more than
anything. I love you.
I love you, Jesus.
I worship and adore you.
Worship and adore you.
Just wanna tell you. Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you more than anything.
Let's bring it up. I love you.
I love you, Jesus.
I worship and adore.
I worship and adore.
Just want to tell you.
Just want to tell you.
Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you.
And adore
I worship
you.
And adore.
Just wanna tell ya.
Just want to tell
you. Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you more than anything.
Good morning. You know, one thing about being a child of God that we should never forget, that there are a lot of benefits that have been afforded to us. So this morning, we'll be reading from Psalms 103, and I'll be reading the 2nd through the 11th verse. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgiveth all thine iniquities, who healeth all thy diseases, who redeemeth thy life from destruction, who crowneth thee with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfieth thy mouth with good things, so that thy youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord executeth righteousness and judgment for all that are oppressed. He made known his ways unto Moses, his acts unto the children of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and plenteous in mercy. He will not always chide, neither will he keep his anger forever. He hath not dealt with us after our sins, nor rewarded us according to our iniquities. For as the heaven is high above the earth, so great is his mercy toward them that fear him. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come this morning, as we do every morning, with a grateful heart, knowing, God, that we are so blessed to have you as our God. For you are great, and you are awesome in all of your ways. God, you've been so good to us, not because we've been so good to you, but you've just been good because you are good. You are God, and there is no one like you. And so, Father, we come today to lift you up. We come to give you glory. We come to give you honor. We come to praise your name. And for many of us, we come, Lord, today to hear a word from you. For we know that in your word is strength, in your word is power, in your word is healing, in your word is deliverance, in your word is life. And so we come, Father, to hear from you today. For we know that while we enjoy all of your blessings, while we enjoy all of your love and your grace and your mercy, we still have to deal with some trials. We still have to deal with some sufferings. We still have to deal with some problems. But there's good news. And the good news is that there's no problem that you can't solve. And so, Father, as your people pour out their hearts to you this morning, be reminded of what you've already done. For we know that in times of sickness, you've already healed. We know that in times of weakness, you've already given us strength. We know, Father, that when we were lost, you directed us back home. Father, when we fell short, you forgave us. So, God, we realize that whatever our problem, whatever our situation, whatever our struggle, the answer is in you. And it would be wise if that we would not focus on our problem, but that we would instead focus on the problem solver. For there's no place too low, there's no river too wide, there's no mountain too high, Father, that you can't come and deliver, heal, and restore. Because all power is in your hand. And so we're not going to put our trust in man. We're not going to put our trust in ourselves and our own resources. We come today to the rock, the foundation that can never be shaken. And you've already made the promise that you would never leave us and that you would never forsake us. So today, all of our hope, all of our trust, all of our faith, Lord, we put in the one and only true and living God. And we as your servants will forever give you the honor and the praise that you and only you deserve. Father, all these blessings today we ask in the mighty and powerful name of Jesus. We pray. Amen. Amen.
Come on. at this time. This is time for our tithes and offering. Our ushers, you're in charge. We'd ask everyone to stand, please, and be guided by the ushers, please. Stand at this time and be directed by the ushers. Amen.
Our Father, we come again to thank you for this day, Lord. We want to thank you for this offering that has been raised, Lord. We want to thank you for those who gave and those who did not have it to give, Lord. We pray that you will multiply it, Lord, and use it in the way that you have it to be used. These blessings in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Good morning, St. Luther.
Good morning.
At this time, we'd like to recognize our visitors. If you have visited here at St. Luther, would you please stand? Amen. 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 Come on, St. Luther. We welcome you here today.
We welcome you here today.
With open arms.
With open arms.
And the love of God.
And the love of God.
And we ask that you come again.
And we ask that you come again.
Real soon.
Real soon.
Amen. Amen. Be blessed. Now we have our interpreter dancers.
Lord is my pillar and my fortress, my deliverer, my God, my rock. Lord is my pillar, my fortress, my deliverer, my God, my rock, in whom I take refuge. He is my shield and the horn of my salvation. He is my shield and the horn of my salvation. He is my shield and the horn of my salvation. He's my high tower. He's my high tower. I will call on the name of the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. I will call on the name of the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. I will call on the name of the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. Said, I will call on the name of the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. Said, I will call on the name of the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. I will call on the name of the Lord.
Let's give the children a hand. Amen. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. If you don't mind, Deacon Hunter, will you turn the monitors up for me? verse Amazing Grace. Right now, Lord, we come to you this morning to say thank you. Father God, there's no other help I know that we can have. And I thank you for it, Father God. Lord, I ask you to remove thyself out the way. Lord, I ask you to speak through me. Lord, let our heart be hearing of your word. Father God, we love you and we give you all the praise. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. I give thanks to God. You may be seated. Because he is the creator of the universe. I've learned that he's the P in power. I've learned he's the P in peace because he created peace. I also learned that he is the omniscient God, meaning he has infinite awareness and is all knowing. I also learned that he is what? Omnipotent. Meaning he has unlimited authority and he has all power in his hand. I also learned that he is omnipresent. Mean he can be at your place, my place, and their place at the same time. And I also learned that he's a mighty God. He's a great God. He's the one and only true living God. And I just want to tell him thank you. I want to thank him for healing me. Thank him for waking me up and breathing the breath of life in my body this morning. Thank him for clothing me in my right mind. Thank him for all the joy in my soul. I just want to tell him thank you. I don't know about you. But if God got me out of some kind of mess, took away all my stress, I got to tell him thank you. I don't think somebody heard me. If God take me all out of all my mess, kept me from stress, somebody needs to tell him thank you. I know God did something for you because I can see you. God woke you up this morning and enabled you to come to church without assistance and you sit and be quiet. We got to do better than that to our pastor. In his absence on vacation, I thank him for another opportunity to share a word with you. And I pray to God that they will have traveling grace and mercy. To Reverend Roberts and my fellow clergymen, mind what you want in the corner, pushing you all the way through. And to everyone that makes up this fine body of Christ, there's a word today. And it's found in the book of Jonah, chapter 1, verse 4. Jonah, chapter 1, verse 4. When you get there, you'll find these words. But the Lord sent out a great wind on the sea, and there was a mighty tempest on the sea, so that the ship was about to be broken up. Now, this one I just want to briefly talk about, just like there was a purpose for the Lord to send that wind, God has a purpose just for you and me. I don't know your purpose. You don't know my purpose. But if we get in the right place, then we be in the right place for God to do his purpose. God had a purpose for Jonah. And that was to go to Nineveh, preach the gospel against all the crazy sin they were doing, and inform them to repent, choose God, and get by him and follow him. Now, on this journey, I realized that a lot of us cannot follow God. Why? We too busy trying to lead God and tell God what to do. As if we know what's around the corner. As if we know what's going to happen tomorrow. As if we know what's going to happen next week. Jonah tried to get away from his purpose. He tried to get away from what God purposed him to do. He tried to flee to another city called Tarsus. But we find out in this text that didn't even work. I know Jonah was scared about what was taking place over there in that land, but Jonah didn't realize he had to show mercy towards them. Jonah didn't think now those people might have been idolatrous. They might have been sinning, but he disobeyed God. Now, they didn't deserve mercy for what they were doing, but he deserved mercy. What a unbalanced situation. That didn't mean how quickly Jonah forget by his disobedience. I didn't know what Jonah was doing. But I realized that's how we do today. We see someone else doing wrong. But their wrong is not worse than our wrong, but we want God to give them their wrath. We don't want to take the wrath. We want God to punish them, but we don't want God to punish us. But one thing about God's salvation is for everyone who repents. And let the Lord be their Savior, not just the ones that we want to be saved, not just the one Jonah wants to be saved, but it's for everybody. Now I'm not talking about the ones that don't have a changed heart. God can see what's inside the heart. Just like today. God will get some of us out of bad situations. And we are turned right back around and back in another bad situation. I don't think somebody heard me because I ain't heard nobody say too much. God don't bring you out of something so you can turn right back around and get back in it. Somebody said he calmed my blood pressure down, but then you turn right back around, eat 4 pieces of chicken, ice cream, and apple pie. Turn right back around and get yourself back in trouble. Somebody might say, well, I start drinking again, I start smoking again, I start lusting again, I start gossiping again. Oh, wait a minute. Some of us still doing that gossiping. But is there anybody here this morning that can agree with me 100% that would say, if God get me out of that mess, I'm not going back. I'm going to stay out of trouble and go to church and do what God say and be obedient and not be like Jonah, disobedient, and be blessed. I don't want you to agree with me just because you're in church. Because when you leave church, you got to know how things work. When you leave church, you got to put on the whole armor of God. When you leave church, you got to know how to fight the enemy. But then you got to know who the enemy is. See, you can't reload on scripture if you don't have no scripture in you. You can't reload on the word of God if you don't have no word in you. Because there ain't nothing going to come out of you that's not in you. You got to realize when Paul said, when I tried to do right, evil is on every
side. And guess what? Eva don't care what kind of degree you got. It don't care if you have a GED. It don't care if you have a PhD. It don't care if you have a divinity degree. But if you don't have that G-O-D, it's going to knock you down just like Mike Tyson. In this text, he sent the great wind on the sea with a purpose. Don't get this misconstrued. That wind was sent for a reason. Jonah was given explicit instruction to go to Nineveh. But Jonah disobeyed those instructions. And he took off to Tarshish. But what he didn't know that God had a purpose on his life. God sent a storm to the sea. Letting Jonah know, I see you disobeying me. Just like you tell some of us today, we might get out there doing whatever, but when that conscience hits you, it letting you know that God sees you. I might not see you, but God does. They tell me that the storm was a blistering wind. The storm had waves knocking against the ship, almost destroying the ship. They said the storm was so bad that the oldest person, the stoutest person, got scared. Got scared, and they all began to pray to their God. But that strongest person said, this is not no ordinary storm. Just like today, I see that many people would not pray until they get in a bad situation. And no matter how you try to hide your wrongdoing, God see every move you make. And he know the reason why you did it. You see, I told you in the beginning that God was omniscient. He has infinite awareness and he knows all. So if hurting, if you are hurting late at night, God knows. If you got bills and don't have no money, God knows. If you've been mistreated left and right, God knows. But he just waiting for you to come to him and ask him to work things out. Because you never know what purpose God has for you in your life. You never know who God is trying to help, and he might just be using you for his purpose. See, God might put you in a difficult situation. He might put you in that situation so you can help somebody else. Well, when I think about that situation, I think about Elijah. How he was on Mount Carmel bragging about his God. All about what his God can do and what his God will do. And he put up a challenge with Baal prophets and told them to get something for a bull for a burnt offering and call on your God. Let's see what God can come to play. They tell me they call him 1, 2, and 3 times. Baal still didn't come. But when Elijah called on Jesus, when he called on God, everything began to work out right. But then look what happened. Elijah got scared, got feared. He ran away and hid in a cave. But what he didn't realize, God still had a purpose on his life. He still had a purpose because he had to go anoint two kings and a prophet and his successor. But see, we never know what kind of purpose God has for us. They said he ran and hid himself in the cave. But he had to anoint the two kings, Hazael and Jehu, and the prophet Elisha. So no matter what situation you might be in today, God is going to put you in a place so you can benefit for his purpose. Jonah had a purpose on his side to go to Nineveh. Elijah had a purpose on his life to anoint the kings and prophets. Then here comes Jesus. Jesus was on the boat, which he invited some of his disciples to go on the other side. But a storm broke out. Now, the disciple faith was tested. So you don't know how strong your faith is until it's tested. Every child of God gonna have a test of their faith. I don't care what your title is. If you're a child of God, your faith is gonna be tested. But it seemed like to me the disciples' faith should have been stronger than what it was. Because they had seen Jesus perform miracles after miracles. They had seen him make the lame walk. Seen him make the blind see. Made the dumb talk. That seen them cast out devil. So why did they not have a faith of a grain of a mustard seed? He didn't ask for much. God don't ask us for much. Just a grain of mustard seed. Now the mustard seed is already little. But a grain of the mustard seed? You mean tell me that's all the faith I got to have? To say on God's word, when you look at Matthew 17:20, it said, and Jesus said to them, because of your unbelief, for I verily say unto you, if you have faith as a grain of a mustard seed, you shall say unto the mountain, remove his yonder place, and he shall remove. Then he said, ain't nothing shall be impossible for you. Coming up real soon, we have another situation. We have a political situation. And the purpose on your life is to vote. I'm not telling you who to vote for. But if you put yourself in a difficult situation, then you'll be crying to God to help you out of it. If it's God's purpose for you to vote, then you need to get out there and vote. If it's God's purpose for you to usher, you need to be ushering. If it's God's purpose for you to be a deacon, you need to be a deacon. If it's God's purpose for you to sing, you need to get in the choir. Don't hold back on your purpose. Because God is trying to help you and somebody else. So when you face all these difficult situations like Jonah faced, like Elijah faced, like Jesus faced, it does not exempt you from God's purpose. Because his purpose is going to be done whether you want to do it or not. God's purpose happened to Jesus over 2,000 years ago. And his purpose was to come to die for our sin. Something we did. If he were disobedient, what would happen to us today? If he never died on the cross, what would happen? If he told him, nah, you're not going to put them crown of thorns on my head. If he said, you're not going to spear me in the side, pierce me in the side. What would happen to us today? We got to take God's purpose and our purpose and connect them and know what we need to do. We got to be obedient. Because if you're not obedient, you're going to find yourself hiding in the cave. You're going to find yourself in a storm that you can't get out of, and you're going to want God to remove the storm. You're going to want God to take everything from you. You want everything easy. But one thing about it, don't nothing come easy. If you're a child of God, you got to suffer for something. You got to suffer for Christ. You got to go through something. You got to have God with you at all time. He's just like American Express. I can't leave home without him. I might be need him on the left. The enemy is over there. I might need him on the right. The enemy is over there. I might need him in front of me. The enemy is there. I might need him behind me. The enemy is there. I might need him above me. The enemy is there. But if the enemy is beneath you, stop him. I'm so thankful that he sent his only begotten son on the cross. I'm so thankful that he stood there and took all the punishment. I'm so thankful that the blood ran down. I'm so thankful that he stayed on the cross. I'm so thankful that he hung his head and died for you and I. I'm thankful. And I'm grateful. And I will never forget it. But before I go to my seat, I want to tell you a story. I know I have said it many times before. One day, I was on my way to do a job in Edwards. Show you how much faith this elder woman had. Mind you, on the way going from Clinton to Edwards, I was singing and praising God. Looking on my computer that I had an order to turn somebody's lights out. When I get there, Edwards, the old woman was speaking in tongues. I didn't know what she was saying, but I knew she was talking to God. No, I had already been in the midst of his presence. But when I got to her house, she was talking to him. See, God had a purpose on our life, and he had a purpose on my life. When I got there, I got out the truck, went around. See, this was back in the old days. Now they'll turn your lights off when you're not at home. They do it at the office. Went around to the house. And I went to put my hand on the meter and could not move. I put my hands down. I said, Lord, you ain't got to take me number once. Walked back to my truck. Drove back to Jackson, Mississippi. Before I got to Jackson, God had already suspended all the disconnection for a whole week for that woman. See, that purpose, if I was not in the right place, if I was not in the right frame of mind, then I would have missed the purpose God had for me in that woods. If she was not in the right frame of mind, then she would have missed her purpose that God had for her. So he blessed her and blessed me because I was obedient to what God wanted me to do. As I go to Missy, I tell you this today. Stay in the will of God and do not forget God might have a purpose on your life. God bless you. The doors of my Father's house is open. You can come by letter, Christian experience, or up on a watch care. You come for a candidate of baptism. As the choir sing, come to Jesus. Let it meditate on your heart. That God will change your life if you let him. Let it meditate in your heart that I need a change in my life. I need you to make my life brand new. I need you to take this off for me. But he never would do it if you don't step out on faith. Why don't you come today? Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. God bless you, God bless you. Do we have any?